Hello and welcome to our final episode of our BDSM podcast series. Hopefully you've stuck around with us for the whole time and hopefully you've enjoyed it. This is the 5 of 5, just to give you an idea of how you are in case you lose track. They are hopefully kind of lovely and ordered and wonderfully clear and everything. And this one is slightly different from our previous ones. This one is actually a reflection on the earlier episodes with members from the Warwick University Fetish Society. I'm speaking to the wonderful president and welfare officer today and hearing their thoughts on it and reflecting. Hopefully with an idea of what can we take away from the previous episodes, what did they like, what they didn't, what did they not like. Ooh, I'm going to keep that in because that made me giggle. Overall, it should hopefully be a really wonderfully kind of reflective conversation. It should hopefully be really enlightening and hopefully get you to reflect and think about on the things that you liked and disliked in this series. Let us know your thoughts. There is going to be a survey going out with this and it's going to be next week as well. It would be incredibly helpful. It should only take you about a minute and a half, 2 minutes to fill in. And it just kind of really helps us shape where our future seasons go and our future episodes. There are other episodes coming up, the odd standalone episode, but do you want more of the series or did you want to go back to the individual episodes? Let us know. But without further ado, I'll pass you over to the conversation and I hope you enjoy. Hello everyone and welcome back to our final episode of our BDSM podcast series. I'm joined today by some kind of really exciting guests. I kind of reached out to them right at the beginning before I'd even recorded any of these episodes as a kind of a, ooh, would you be interested kind of thing? And I've kind of reached out back again and they're still interested. Yay! I'll let them introduce themselves properly. But this episode is going to be a conversation between myself, my dulcet tones are kind of riding into your ears through whatever kind of podcast setting you choose to listen to, whether it's through games or washing up or on the bus. I mean, I think there's something kind of kinky there about kind of listening to that BDSM on the bus and no one knowing. But this final episode is going to be a discussion with them, and it's going to be a reflection on the previous 4 episodes. Some of them we haven't been able to listen to just because we're on super tight time. I say previous 4, I mean previous 3 because the 4th one isn't even released yet, as it were. But they are the University of Warwick Fetish Society, and I am joined by Cara and Gala, but I said I'll let them introduce themselves properly and a bit more about what Warwick Fetish Society is, also known as FetSoc. So if we call it FetSoc throughout, that's what we mean there. I just kind of wanted to have a conversation with them in regards to what their thoughts were on the previous episodes. Is there anything new they found? Is there anything they wanted to say? Is there anything really important they feel like you should be focusing on or ignoring? With these podcasts, I'm not making any kind of specific point or argument, and disagreement will happen, and that is okay. Let's have that disagreement as and when we need to. So, first of all, I'm going to pass on over to Gala. Would you like to introduce yourself, then Cara, and kind of the things that you do as a society? So over to you, Gala.
Oh, thank you. My name's Gala. Thank you so much for having us on this podcast. I'm the president of Warwick Fetish Society.
And we also have Cara.
Hi, I'm Cara. Thank you. We love being here. This is so exciting. And I'm the welfare exec. So I'm kind of in charge of making sure we do things safely. And if anyone has any concerns, they'll come to me. So kind of what we do, we have weekly munches. A munch is a non-play kink event. So they normally happen in pubs in the UK because we love our pubs. But it's basically just a social where we can talk about kink stuff and socialize with other kinky people. We also have educational talks. So we had one on Monday, which was on edge play. We've done previous stuff on consent, negotiation, pet play, how to do kink on a budget. And that's sort of kind of what we do. Cool. I'll pass back to Gala.
I also had a quick question because you mentioned this. What's edge play?
Oh, yeah. So edge play is not edging, very easily confused. It is not edging.
Edge and play... it's also not just something that has an edge to it. Because we get lots of people saying that as well.
So hang on, what is edging? We're now introducing other things.
Oh, I'm sorry.
For clarity, I do know what these are, but like I'm not sure all of our listeners do. So first of all, could you define what edging is? Could you define what you mean by something having an edge to it? And then could you define what edge play is? Because we've now broken this down very quickly.
Of course. So edging is where you hold someone on the edge of orgasm or ejaculation or both and kind of deny them and deny them and deny them. And then eventually the orgasm that you have after that is much bigger, much better in a subjective way. And it's a type of play that people do. Gala, do you want to tell us about what kink with an edge is?
So kink with an edge, anything that has a sharp edge to it can be used. For example, knife play is a thing. We've got blood play, which is a bit more risky. We've got lots of times people in kink situations want to have some form of threat or some form of risk or thrill, because that, of course, releases a lot of hormones. It releases adrenaline. It makes it so much more intense for some people. So having an element of a risk of having a knife or having a blade, even if it's not doing anything other than being there in someone's hand as a threat, can be very useful in a scene. So although that in itself can be considered edge play, it is not what we mean. So edge play in itself, just to continue from what Kara was saying, is where you have something with an inherent risk. So one of the things I say to remember this is, if you think of something an edgy person, someone you would consider edgy would do, it's anything with this inherent risk would be considered edge play. So something like knife play is edge play, but not because it has a blade or because it has an edge.
Okay, so just to kind of build on that as a question, where do you draw the risk? Because at the end of the day, crossing a road is risky, but like obviously there are levels of risk. So at what point does crossing over into when does it become edgy, as it were?
Okay, I think that's a really good question, because there is a thing that is edge play that a lot of people think, oh, that's easy, everyone does that, and that's bondage. Like, bondage is inherently risky. You can damage people's nerves. If you tie in the wrong place, you can like lose limbs if you do it wrong. There is a very clear danger if it's done badly, but it's a really popular kink. So a lot of people don't think, oh, bondage, that's so dangerous, that's so edgy, but it is, by the definition of edge play. Well, it's edge play. So a lot of people use a bit of a more colloquial one of edge play is that scary stuff that everyone tells you is why kink is dangerous. So Gala mentioned blood play, so purposefully making someone bleed, or things like electro play, using electricity to stimulate, or needles, or medical play. But they're sort of the scary kink, which I feel horrible saying, because it makes it sound bad, and it's not bad kink, it's just slightly riskier kink. I mean, you're right, everything has risk. So
that's really interesting. Thank you for kind of clarifying that, both of you. So part of what you do there is these kind of, as you said, these educational events. You educate people, for example, in the way that I'm assuming you just have here. What do you mean by these kind of different things? I know as well, I'm actually aware of Work Fetish Society, because last year, or maybe even the year before, sometime between or just before various lockdowns in the UK, they did a workshop on, essentially it was a bondage 101. And it was a kind of, here are some basic ties, this is how not to fuck people up. What are the things that you do? I remember still, I still have pictures actually on my phone, consenting pictures of the actual knots themselves on a friend of mine. So I could like look at them and kind of remember. But things like, you know, keeping like a finger width between kind of like a cylinder tie, which is like anything around a cylinder, which is such as your arm or your legs and so on and so forth. Relatively basic stuff. And I may have got some of the terminology wrong there, but the ideas are there. Column tie, I think actually is what you called it. Yeah, column tie there. They're nodding at me like, yes, that was it. Not cylinder. Okay. Things like that. And they are things I've kind of taken moving forward with people when they've asked me to do stuff. I know in episode two, the one with Lucy Sweetkill, we talked about kind of people who kind of say like, I have no limits. And it's just like bullshit. Yes, you do. You have limits. And one of the things that kind of reminds me of it, these ideas of like, do you know, for example, how to safely tie someone up? It's actually now one of my go-to questions, like, do you know how to do that? Because if someone's sitting there saying they've got no limits, but they don't even know how to do a safe knot, like, I ain't interested because you don't know your ass from your fucking elbow, as far as I'm concerned, when it comes to quote unquote no limits. And actually, if in case you haven't listened to it, Lucy Sweetkill actually says anyone who says no limits is a red flag. And she draws a very clear distinction between people who go, I don't know my limits yet, versus no limits, and actually why no limits is dangerous. So first of all, I guess I just wanted your general thoughts on the podcast episodes that you have been able to listen to. I know you've listened to various different amounts just because of timing and, you know, Gala, do you want to go? What were your thoughts on the episodes that you managed to kind of listen, and what did you like or dislike, frankly, about it?
First of all, I think the idea of having a podcast like this is fantastic, and just opening up the conversation more is just brilliant, because we don't hear enough about this, and it's just great to be able to hear about it in general. And although I've only listened to your third episode, I'm going to listen to more. And it's just been a case of timings that's the reason I haven't listened to more. In general, I don't agree with everything that's been said on the podcast, to be quite honest. But I like the fact, I enjoy the fact that I didn't agree with everything, because often, especially as president of a fetish society, you get an echo chamber in the society of everyone agreeing with you, everyone having the same perspective. And then you go out into the real world, and it feels like everyone in your little bubble who has what you consider a safer, more experienced role within kink, they have different opinions to the rest of the world, and it's like, oh. So it's interesting to challenge or to reevaluate why I think what I think. And sometimes I just come back and I still believe what I believe. And sometimes it's thinking about that and thinking, well, why do I think that this is the way it is? And that's a really good point. So, yeah.
Okay. I will bring you up on that, because I want to know what you get to read with. That's fantastic. So no, I'm glad. And thank you so much for your compliments on the kind of the podcasters as well. That was unexpected, but thank you. That's kind of cool. So the third episode is Allergic to Bad Kink, for those who aren't sure. And that's the one where we talk to Matt, who is an anonymized friend of mine involved in various bits and bobs, who is voice acted by the resident animator of Koi Disrupt, who is just my mate down the road, who is an animator and he wanted to help volunteer. So he was like, are you free for voice acting? And he was like, yeah, all right. But we'll come back to that. But Cara, what were your thoughts? I know you've listened to, I think, the first three, but correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, no, I listened to the first three out of order because I'm a bit of a mess. I really liked, same as Gala, I really liked the podcast. I think, it was really useful listening to your first episode, The Butter Knife, which goes into all the legal stuff, because I listened to it just before we did our Edge Play talk. So then I could go like, oh, guys, I know all this legal stuff now. So it was really useful to get a show off my cool kink knowledge that I got from you guys. And I forget her name, but your guest lawyer on that, she was amazing.
Lex, she's lovely.
Lex, yeah, they were really good. I really loved hearing your professional dominatrix as well. Lucy, that was Sweetcoat. Great.
Lucy Sweetcoat, yes. Also amazing, New York-based dom, yeah.
Yeah, she was lovely. And I loved her discussions of consent and negotiation. Because, I mean, as welfare exec, that's like my big thing. So I really liked hearing how she did it and how she vetted her clients. I think that's really important. Gala's kind of covered a lot about the third one. I think just in general, it was great. And I learned a lot of really nice stuff. So thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you as well for those very nice compliments. It feels a bit odd, like, hearing them, because I've not actually sat down and had a proper conversation with someone about the podcast yet, but after people actually in the podcast. So it's a bit like, oh yeah, you're listeners and you like this. Yay. This is weird. I love it. I'm curious, and I don't know if it's the same or if you even agree. Did you find any kind of problems? I know Gala mentioned, obviously, the third episode, problems was perhaps a statement there, but a disagreement on kind of what was being said. Did you find a similar perspective or not?
I don't think there was. I know what Gala disagreed with, so I think I do agree with her on that one. But I'll let her do it. I think there wasn't anything else specific. I definitely got pretty annoyed talking about the legal stuff with like the husband and the butter knife. I was like, well, that's fucked up. It was more frustration at situations rather than anything anyone was saying.
Okay. Well, I think it would be really nice then to just go back to Gala. Gala, go on. What did he disagree with? What tell us, give us the goss, give us the tea.
So I believe Matt said that when it comes to kink, the onus of responsibility for how the scene goes and for experience and any mishaps that might happen is primarily on the dom or the top. And I kind of disagree with this as someone who is a switch. So I've been on both sides of this. So I've been bottom, I've been top, I've been sub, I've been dom. I've been in threesomes where I'm both at the same time and it gets really confusing. But from my experience of that, and also just experience dating and finding sexual and romantic dates in general on the internet, I've always had the opinion that people need to take regard of their own safety first, that you need to kind of assess the risks involved, and you need to be able to satisfy yourself that you are taking precautions before you trust someone else to do that. It might be that if you're in a long-standing relationship with a partner, by that point you've already got the trust and you don't need to reconfirm it every single scene. You might have to, you might not, depending on the relationship and what's going on. But especially when you're starting with new partners, unfamiliar scenes, anything that you don't know will go correctly more than 90%, I would say you do need to put your own safety and your own good time almost in your own hands. When I go on a date, I always make sure that I text my friends. I always make sure that I show my date if it's from Tinder or somewhere that I don't know them personally from, that I tell them that I've texted my friends. They may or may not be a dangerous person. They might just be a lovely man or woman, but I like to put my own safety in my hands because in some ways it's not about them. It's not about whether they're good or bad. It's about me protecting me because I trust my own ability if they turn out to be someone who will hurt me, then I need to be prepared for that. And I can't say, oh, they're a bad person, they're awful for murdering me, partially because I'll be dead. But I need to know that that was always going to be a possibility, that they were going to hurt me. And I need to make sure that before I go in a space that they would be able to, I'm relatively certain that they won't. And relatively certain that we've got the right sort of expectations. So I say, hey, I'm planning to not get murdered today. Can we have that like communication talk? This okay?
Yeah, that makes that I understand where you're coming from. I'm not going to speak format in any way here. It's kind of an interesting situation for me because I know Matt relatively well. And amusingly, he is actually very safe as a sub when he is. He nearly always messages me addresses, for example, even with established dogs. You know what I mean? So like he does take, so which is interesting because I know he didn't seem like that then. I am gonna perhaps ask a question, and I think maybe he would agree with me on this. I think he would agree with you, knowing him, with everything you've just said there, actually. I think he's perhaps putting a scenario in where if you're tied up on a bed, okay, there is nothing there at the end of the day to prevent that person pummeling the shit out of you or lightly spanking you. And I think that's kind of what he meant there by that. And I think the example he gave was someone with a cane, right? And he admitted he fucked up at least partially there and kind of just assumed, right? He didn't have that conversation. And I think he is someone who would own that, I think. But when, for example, someone is, let's say, restrained or tied up, let's say I'm having a meet with someone and I am a piece of furniture for them, okay? There's nothing for me there to be able to physically stop them, right?
Well, I would stop you there because the whole point of doing kink is you have a safe word, and most of the time that safe word is just going to be stop. If it's not something like these traffic light systems. So we have red, yellow, green. So green is I'm having a great time, please keep going. Red is you stop right now, we stop. And then yellow is I want to kind of continue, but you're going a bit hard, you're reaching my limit. I don't want to say red, but maybe slow down a bit sort of thing. So we have this system because not always, you don't want to stop a scene if you're having fun and you think it can get better. But if you know something's not as enjoyable as it was when it was softer, then you can say yellow and do that. Also, I'm a big fan of, and I know this isn't for everyone, I like communicating during the scene with my partners. So halfway through, I'll say I'm enjoying that, or oh, that's a bit harsh, or something like that. And unless it's a CNC scene, which is consensual non-consent, where you're pretending to not enjoy something that you are enjoying, it's the case that you can quite freely say, oh, I'm not enjoying that, or yes please, or can you do it a bit softer but right there. And having this ongoing dialogue of communication and having this feedback response to everything means that you never get, or you shouldn't ever get to the point where it's breaking limits fully within the scene, because it's always working up or you do it wrong.
But I agree with you. And I think even when you're kind of verbally restricted, there are ways around that you can kind of physically push back. I know one scenario I'm thinking of, if I didn't push back with my feet, the dom stopped. Like the cue there was a physical feedback. But
yes,
if, for example, you say red, like stop, time to stop, absolutely, hard line, we're getting out of here. It's on the dom to stop and recognize that, no? I think
if they don't stop at that point, that's rape.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's assault. I fully agree with you. There's no ifs, there's no buts there. But again, when we're talking about safety, and I think the point that Matt was making there was actually it's the onus is on there to control the entire environment in that room and respect those boundaries when they come up, as it were. I don't know, I'm just kind of thinking, Kara, what are your thoughts on this? Where are you coming from? And I appreciate I've been kind of muddying the waters and being perhaps deliberately provocative. But what are your thoughts on this?
I think with that explanation, that extension to hopefully Matt's thinking, I mean, I see both sides. I agree with Gala. It's the responsibility of everyone in the room to be responsible for their safety. That includes the Dom, that includes the sub. And there's definitely precautions you can take as a sub, as a new sub, to make sure that you're playing with a safe person. And that's the same for a Dom as well. Like you talked about people having no limits. That's a limit for a Dom. That's not a safe sub to play with. So it works both ways. I think it's kind of a complicated thing because accidents happen. Like with Matt's situation, I know that I've been restrained on my knees and I lost balance and I whacked my head on a wall and gave myself a concussion. And now whenever I do a rope talk, I'm like, don't do that. And there's an aspect of some mistakes you kind of have to learn by fucking up, and it's okay to fuck up. Like, it's not the end of the world if someone says red. It's not a bad scene. It's just something happened that we needed to end it. Like, I've said red because I had a really bad itch and it was just ruining the mood. Like, you don't have to red if someone's beating you so hard you're crying your eyes out or anything like that.
I think that's a really good point. We say the traffic light system as if it's kind of a, oh my God, something has gone horrifically wrong and I need to like escape this awful situation. Yeah. Whereas actually, yeah, it could be just, I don't know, the car alarm outside is pissing me off and I'm no longer in the scene. I haven't, as you said, you know. And I think actually, I just wanted to interrupt. I think that's a really important point to make.
Mm.
Like, as well as whoever you are in that scenario, and like all of us will agree in this room, I know this before even saying anything, you know, for any reason whatsoever, you can stop a scene.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be a quote unquote big issue. You know what I mean? It can be literally, oh, I'm hungry. And now what I'm thinking about is pizza. You know what I mean? It could be anything and that's okay. Can I just jump in? Sorry, I know you were going to continue, but can I just jump in?
Of course.
We talked about kind of, you talked about experience there. How does experience play a role in that? So for example, if you're a sub or you're a dom, whatever, listeners, take the role in your mind that you feel most comfortable doing. And let's say you have never done a scene before. Let's say it's your first time ever at bondage. Okay.
Okay.
And I mentioned, I'm using that as an example because I mentioned earlier about various safety, right, with column ties and stuff that you kind of talk. You've never done it before. How does experience play into that? Because someone's going to have a better knowledge of kind of like safety and how things work there than the other. So is there not a kind of a disparate of kind of, I don't want to use power dynamic, but is there not a difference of kind of responsibility of safety there as well that can play a role? How do you conceptualize that? I guess is the question I'm asking you both.
Yeah, I mean, there can be a power dynamic there. And that's sort of explicit in a workshop. There's the dynamic of the teacher and the student. And I would recommend someone go to a workshop before doing any rope, before doing their first rope scene, or at the very least, like, there's some really good YouTube channels that do rope ties. There's loads of online resources for rope. It's really common. Just do your research, give it a quick 5-minute Google, and you're in a much better position rather than coming in completely blind. I think accepting you're inexperienced is good, because it means you have a space to learn. And I think it can also be a double-edged sword if you think you are experienced, because sometimes you can shut off from the learning. And there can be sort of experienced riggers or DOMs or subs might.
So what do you mean by riggers? Sorry, just to interrupt that.
A rigger being a person who ties someone. So there's often, you can use the rope top or rigger or the rope bottom, or some people use a rope bunny to mean the person being tied. So yeah, that's what I mean by rigger. You can get people who are really, really famous, but I mean, they can still make mistakes. Everyone makes mistakes. Experience doesn't protect you from needing to go through all the same safety and skills. And I think that's what Gala was making a point about, how everyone is responsible.
I've actually got a story which kind of includes a few bits of this. I don't know if I should say it, but my partner is actually the one who's going to be helping with the takedown workshop. He is extremely experienced in martial arts. He's done judo.
Just a bit. Yeah. What takedown workshop? Sorry.
So the one that we are doing as part of the Warwick Fetish Society, we're doing a takedown workshop to basically give some basic skills on how to control your partner, how to get them from standing up to sitting down to the floor in a safe, easy way. So we're doing this the Thursday after Valentine's Day, and we're going to be inviting some of our members to join us to learn this. With my partner, who is an experienced martial artist who's done, I want to say, 5, 6, 7 different martial arts, judo, jiu-jitsu, I can't name them all. but he's very experienced. When he met me, he was quite confident, and since then has reevaluated how that comes into kink in general, because there is a different way to approach something in a normal context that's a vanilla context than there is to a kink one. So for example, with rope, you'd not do your what's it called, those little weavy things they do. You wouldn't do like rope art the same way you would do it on a sub for a scene.
You mean like macrame, like when you knit? Like,
yeah, macrame. You wouldn't do macrame the same way you would do it when you're doing it on a sub. Similar to, you wouldn't do your judo takedowns the same way you'd do it on a sub.
Shaking like as high around something like the world's slowest kink scene. Like, don't move, I'm not done. Just trying to throw shade someone's wrist to like a bedpost or something.
I think I've got a new idea for a scene now. It's going to be brilliant. But anyway, he was really confident. He knows how to do every single throw. And he was showing me how he was doing it. And we decided we'd do it on his massive king size bed, because there's a large amount of room and there's no pointy surfaces that could accidentally have me thrown against them. And then we're about half an hour into just showing me how these throw works. One of them he did a little bit harder, and it was on a very soft area of the bed, and I just bounced off the bed as if I was a bit of a rag doll. And it's just because the move works really well in jiu-jitsu, and it works really well in, I think it was judo, but it doesn't work well in a bed because the floor's different. And I bounced off the bed, hit the wall, elbow first, and I started laughing because that's my pain spot. So I hit my elbow, and basically I said, I'm fine, to keep going. And he was like, I'm not. And this is an example of him questioning his own ability to the point that he's no longer in the mood, and he had to safe word, because although I was fine, I didn't mind the fact that I had a very large bruise, but he did, because he never, before that point, he didn't think that he could hurt someone with something he was so experienced with. So first of all, it's touching on what we said earlier about DOMs being able to safe word and being able to get out of the scene, and even something like thinking about something and reevaluating and wanting to have that space to do so is a great reason. Any reason's a great reason to safe word. But also, it's the case that having a bit too much confidence sometimes is not the best and can lead to problems. And anyone, no matter their experience, can have a bit of a fuck up. But as long that we've had cuddles and I had ice on my elbow, not because I wanted it, just because it made him feel better. But yeah, that, I thought that was a good story.
No, I think that makes sense. And you said, I think it kind of encapsulates a lot of the things that we were talking about there, kind of in practice. I think, yeah, a lot of the things we talk about when it comes to, I guess, just sex generally, but specifically on BDSM, yeah, it sounds brilliant on kind of abstract paper and everyone kind of gets that, but actually in practice it feels more alien. People are often very scared about kind of breaking moods or kind of the extra steps that kind of accompany sex, as it were. And again, particularly kind of something like BDSM, I guess. So we've kind of spoken about there about kind of things that you kind of found kind of interesting, things that perhaps you kind of disagreed with or kind of found maybe problematic, or however you want to phrase that. I mean, we've discussed it. Is there anything else? Is there anything like you're particularly curious about that you would be like, oh God, I wish I wanted to hear more about that, or anything from that kind of perspective you think? Gala, what about yourself? Anything? We have Cara raising her hand. Go on, Cara.
So it's, I think partly because this is a bit of my pet project at the moment, it's something I'm really looking into, is shame in kink. And I think with your podcast and Queer Disrupt and how it builds into sort of LGBT issues as well, and like the queerness as a whole concept, I think shame we're pretty familiar with in the sense of like internalized homophobia or internalized transphobia. That's sort of well recognized how that happens in society. And I think people don't talk about shame in kink very often. Like in my capacity as welfare exec, I get a lot of members come to me like, am I a bad person that I have this kink? Like, we've mentioned consensual non-consent before, and obviously rape is a horrifying, immoral act. And yet here are people going, that idea is really hot. And I think that for me, the difference is, well, it's the idea, it's the fantasy. The fact that they're concerned and they feel shame about it is sort of the proof that they aren't an immoral person about to go out and assault people.
They aren't, for want of a better term, they aren't actually rapists. And no one is saying that they are approving of rapes either, just to be crystal clear.
We did have a discussion on Monday after our Edge Play talk, because we had a question that was kind of a precursor to what is going to be talked about in more detail with the shame talk later this term. But we had someone saying, what's the difference between wanting to do it and fantasizing about something? I think the example we had was violence against women, and saying, what's the difference between that and actually being a horrible person who wants to hurt women? That was a question. And I remember I said at the time, it's similar to thinking about role-playing games in general, because it is a role-playing thing. You're playing a sadist, and you're not actually hurting someone because you want to cause them pain and sadness. You're doing it because you want to cause them pain and satisfaction in some way. And if you think about people playing Call of Duty or others playing Dungeons and Dragons, both of these have the idea that in the game you can do some quite horrific stuff. You can murder people in Call of Duty and in Dungeons and Dragons and in all sorts of LARP, so live action role-playing games. You can hurt people, you can stab them, you can, I don't know the dynamics of things, but you can do some really dodgy stealing and manipulating and lying, and that doesn't make you a horrible person for doing that within something that you have no, doesn't have the consequences and will not hurt anyone, because it's either a video game or a role-playing game, and you know that everyone else who's playing the game with you knows it's just a game, and there won't be that actual consequences and hurt given to that other person. And I think that is the distinction with kink and something that isn't kink, especially with non-consensual stuff or consensual non-consent. The difference would be that you've consented beforehand and that the other person wants to do that specific thing and has expressly said it beforehand. And there are barriers like safe words to make sure that it stays consensual, basically.
Yeah. As well, I'll swing back in a second, Cara, because I think I'm kind of really curious to hear what you're saying in regards to kind of like your pet project there. I think there's also, I know as well, there's been a lot of shame around, just to use this example that we're kind of running with here, women who have kind of had the rape fantasy. I use that rape fantasy in quotation marks there as a kind of the idea of, you know, maybe it's hot for someone to kind of, you know, as if a stranger was to walk in whilst I was in the shower and just, oh, take advantage of me. And that very much is a fantasy, whereas obviously, frankly, the reality of if someone actually walked is fucking terrifying, right? And I say this as someone who isn't quite the same, I appreciate it. Someone walked into my house like a month ago whilst I was in the bath and I live by myself, and it's like a complete stranger. No idea who it was, he was trying to rob me. Scared the ever loving shit out of me. I think I scared him more because I ran into the corridor naked. But but you know, I had to like state them to the police and everything. It was horrible. There is that very clear distinction between, oh, wouldn't it be hot if, like, you know, a young attractive man walked in and just kind of, oh, so I think there's that kind of shame both ways, both as the kind of, again, I'm not comfortable with these words, but for want of a better phrase at the time, kind of the perpetrator and the victim in these kind of particular role plays. But okay, so you saying as well, fair Carl, you get people coming up to you and being like, ah, does this make me a bad person? And you kind of cover that. So I'm kind of curious, like, well, how do you see we deal with this? Like, what's your takeaway? What are you doing with this, I guess?
Yeah. So for me, if I have a member come up to me, and it's happened a few times, other examples that have happened have been someone's been into age play, like littles, and they're like, how does I'll explain what a little is. So a little is someone who takes on the role of a childlike person, and they often have a caregiver. It's a type of dom sub dynamic, so it's a power play. And they were like, I like the thought of taking care of a little, and I like the thought of having sex with my little and doing childlike things with them. Does that like relate to paedophilia? Am I a horrible human who's now attracted to children? And I'm like, no, because you're wanting to do this in a framework of kink. They aren't, as Gala was saying, it's about the consent. It's like, when you had that random dude turn up in your house, it's the actual experience is horrifying, but we can have the fantasy and the pretend in the framework that keeps it safe, in the kink, in the little can say no at any point, the little can say stop.
So at the risk of kind of over-egging the cake, perhaps, the idea obviously that an actual child isn't able to consent in the same way. If you're interested in pup play, or if you're a furry,
exactly,
into like bestiality, or you're interested in having kind of sexual interactions with, you know, with animals or children, if we go back to this kind of heavy on the quotation marks here, kind of rape fantasy or consensual non-consent, I think is the actual kind of terminology we normally use in this kind of community. CNC is for short. It doesn't mean you're actually interested taking having sex non-consensually or sexual any sort of sexual interaction non-consensually.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. I think for me the main thing that I tell people is any thought is okay. It's the action and how we take action about that thought that has a morality around it. So if a person has a thought like, I'm in the shower, some really hot guy is going to break in the door, and I'm just so beautiful and he can't control himself. Like, that's really good for your self-esteem. And there's like that aspect of control, like they can't, I'm just going to have my control taken away. And that's a really big thing in kink, is control and lack of control. So you reframe this horrible situation into, actually sounds quite attractive when I say it like that. I mean, it might not be for everyone. It's personal preference, but the fantasy is often not, oh, I want to do this horrifying act. It's, I want this interaction with control, or I want this interaction with how someone else's actions reflect on my self-esteem, or it's kind of a bit more, the psychology behind it is what I'm really excited about at the moment. You mentioned about rape fantasies. I think I saw a statistic that like 40% of women have had one at some point. That doesn't mean like 40% of women want that to happen to them. That's absolutely not true. But it's that fantasy of control.
It's important to say that as well. But yeah, I think yes. Absolutely. Yeah, I remember thinking, I can't remember the actual stat, but it's like, if it's the first time you see it, it's often, it feels kind of alarmingly high. You're like, oh my God, you know what I mean? But actually, if you look in a room of 10 people or 10 women, the chances are more than a couple have at some point kind of gone, oh, that would kind of be kind of attractive as an idea. The reality obviously being extremely different. What are you doing then about that? You mentioned this kind of stuff. Are you looking at kind of things moving forward, or are you going to do anything about that? Are you going to do a talk maybe, or what? Oh, okay, go on.
Yeah. So the Wednesday after Valentine's Day, we have a talk on shame and aftercare. So I've wrapped in, because it's going to be kind of a heavy topic, I've kind of wrapped in aftercare as well as like a how we cope with difficult feelings that may come up after we do a scene, just in general. I thought they went well together. I mean, I'm graduating this year, so there's not going to be much more I can do with Warwick Fetsock. But I mean, if a magical opportunity fell out of the sky to do more work on this, I would absolutely love to. If anyone wants to hit me up for that, just shameless self promo.
Go for it. You got the platform. I'm sorry, Carla. What were you going to say? Sorry.
I was just going to add another reason that I've seen about going back to CNC, so consensual non-consent. Another reason that it's quite popular is there is this idea with sexism that women don't want to have sex, and it's seen as shameful to want it in general. So one of the reasons that I've heard, and I've in some ways experienced sometimes, I just want someone else to say you're having it, full stop. I don't need to feel shameful for wanting it, because whether I want it or not does not matter. I'm having this thing. And in some ways that's quite freeing, and not to have to think society does or doesn't, because I am no longer in control to such an extent with CNC. And it's often the case that I've seen that someone gets harassed, and it's maybe not very serious harassment on the street, but usually some sexist remarks or some people in some ways objectifying someone, and then they're like, right, I just need to vent. And one of the ways that people do that is with CNC or with kink that involves losing that control to someone that they trust, because in some ways that helps to mend the situation. And there is, Cara knows more about this than me, but some studies about healing trauma with kink, and that's one of the ways that it can be done.
So just to clarify, I know neither of you had the opportunity, but the next episode coming out at the time of the recording, I know it's tomorrow actually, so we're recording this Thursday before the last one, called Spanking on the NHS. That one actually looks at how people use BDSM and kink as a way to reconceptualize things like chronic pain, or how to kind of reconceptualize the way they kind of understand things moving forward. I think that actually links really nicely to the final part of kind of our conversation, I think, in a kind of a really useful way. And the question I'm going to ask you both in turn is what was your kind of your biggest kind of interesting takeaway from here? And I'm going to start by sharing my one, because I think this is kind of a useful reflective conversation for me as well. And I think there was a lot that I enjoyed in the conversation. So there was I've literally spoken about this now for hours and hours and hours, and thought about it now for hours as well. But that kind of this idea of shame and of trauma, I think, and using BDSM to reconceptualize my, and I think it was probably quite obvious in the actual podcast, was with Lucy Sweetkill, episode 2, about her reading on why financial domination is becoming more popular and why financial domination is a thing. And it's the idea that when we exist within a capitalist society, we are so traumatized by the kind of circulation of capital and the way it kind of becomes such a kind of damaging force in our life. She said she's not surprised that people have eroticized it as a way of kind of dealing with essentially the trauma of capitalism in our kind of daily society. And I think that's a really interesting kind of take on both capitalism, but also just the way we kind of deal with these kind of stressful situations. And it made me think as well of, this is entirely anecdotal. I have no studies entirely, but this is entirely just my own anecdotal thoughts on this. A lot of the people I know who are subs in real life, sorry, people that I know who are subs in their quote unquote real life, they often people who I would say are very organized, controlling, again in quotation marks, kind of people who are very much in control of their own life. They have very kind of, and I think a lot of them get into the headspace of that kind of, I don't have to fucking think about things anymore in that kind of way. They can, as you said, you mentioned control is a really important part of BDSM and comes up a lot. But that kind of freedom from control, I think, is a kind of a super important kind of element for those people that I know. And again, that's anecdotal, but I'm sure other people have similar anecdotal kind of, I'm getting lots of nods from the gallery in that kind of framework. And it kind of, and actually the best Dom, I know it's really interesting, the best Dom I know, and he is the best Dom by like a country mile, I know, is actually very soft-spoken, very, he looks physically, I mean, he works out physically, he's a very attractive man, but actually talking to him, I wouldn't go as far as to say shy, but he's actually a remarkably reflective and introverted and intelligent person. But this kind of Dom persona, for want of a better phrase, is not that. It's the difference between going to him for a meet and then just having a coffee with him is kind of wonderful. And we were talking about this book the other day about kind of like emotions that, like, you know, in the English language doesn't have a word for, you know, like crazy stuff like that. But actually in the bedroom, he's a nasty bitch. You know what I mean? I'm sure he wouldn't mind. He's actually listening to these seasons, so like he's gonna know exactly. So like, I don't think he would mind that, me saying that about that. So again, I think there's a kind of, it's almost like a safe, quote unquote, performative space to enact the things that we can't do, or we don't do, not that we can't, we don't do or won't do in kind of daily life. And I think that's, having that safe space to do that in, particularly in relation to sex, can be a wonderfully kind of healing, or a space where we can embrace parts of our life where we don't always otherwise get. I'm going to just kind of ask what your takeaways were. I'll start with Cara, I guess, and then we'll move to Gala, unless you have a particular preference either way. Cool.
I'm happy to go first. Yeah. I mean, what you've just said has made me think of like 500 more things to say. So That's really helpful.
Sorry.
It's fine. I think it's important that we don't pathologize the relation between trauma for some people and kink, because it is literally only in the last few years that being kinky and paraphilia has come out of the DSM and has only been pathologized in cases of distress.
So I'm going to just hold you there, only because you said a lot of words there that used a lot
of
things. So paraphilia, yeah. I mean, I do know what these are, but not maybe earlier. Can you just define what they are, if that's okay?
Of course. So a paraphilia is defined in the DSM as a, I think para is Latin for like weird or obscure and other, and then philia is obviously love. So it's kind of non-normal love. So things like attraction to trees is dendrophilia. And that's also where we get words like paedophilia. That's a paraphilia. And so there's a whole list of
them. Sorry to interrupt. What's the DSM?
I'm not sure I can remember exactly what it stands for, but it's basically the big medical textbook that defines the variation of mental illness and what we pathologize and treat, and say, this is something that is wrong. This is something that's an illness. This is something we might medicate a person on. So it's only very recently that BDSM and paraphilia and kink has been withdrawn from that as being something that's medically wrong with someone. And while there's definitely, I've seen some really good studies that link trauma, especially for people who are survivors of sexual assault, they can find con-non-con a really healing process by reclaiming the power in that dynamic. But I think it can also be dangerous to say, oh, well, if you have trauma, that makes you kinky. So it's like, they're not necessarily related quite like that. But I think it's a lovely topic. I love it. I love learning about that kind of thing.
Can I perhaps just shift the question very slightly with you then?
Of course.
So you said you had a million and one other questions, 500 or more questions. What are some of the questions, and to give you, so I'm not going to go into a conversation here to answer it, but I'd be curious, like, what questions are you reflecting on? What questions are you taking away from this conversation? What questions would you encourage the listeners to kind of think about moving forward? What, and you can just spit them out. You can give answers, perhaps briefly, some of them, but go on.
Sure. So, I mean, what I've been thinking about a lot with this conversation and with listening to your podcasts is, like, I almost want to be a bit more activist-y about my kink. Like, how can we look at the legal situation and make changes with that? How can we protect people and educate people and educate ourselves and keep learning? I've said what I'm interested in at the moment is, like, shame, the psychology of kink. That's something I'm really excited to learn more about and be more involved in. That's just like my pet project, and I'm sure there's other projects that other people are interested in. Kind of, what does kink mean to you, and how is that incorporated into your life or not, as the case may be?
Cool, thank you. No, I think that's a really good point at the end there to kind of, before I pass over to Gala, kind of wrap up with your side. Because, yeah, your kink is not necessarily my kink. I had a very interesting request. I mean, I won't say specifically what it is because it will make that person extremely identifiable. But a very interesting request the other day of the role play. And I was just like, that's a new one. And I remember saying that. And I was clumsy in the way I said it. I remember going, oh, that's a new one. Not come across that one before. And I think it came across more of a kind of a kink shame rather than a just surprise from my kind of side of things. And it was an online conversation. They ended up just kind of blocking me entirely, which is a shame because I actually would have done it and I would have been up for it. And I think it would have been quite interesting. And it was just surprise. But to say that it was a completely benign kink, but it was definitely a more unusual one, to put it that way. And I think they were so used to people going like, ah, as a response, that when I went, oh, that's a new one, they kind of Locked in. So if they ever listen to this, I am so sorry, genuinely. It wasn't a kink shaming. It was just a genuine surprise. over to you, Carla, to kind of, I guess, have the final word, I guess, on this. No pressure.
No pressure. Well, what I've kind of taken away is there's just so many different stories, and even hearing about the first, second and fourth episodes that I've sadly not listened to yet, and I do say yet, but there's so many different perspectives and stories when it comes to kink, and it's so sad that sometimes you see it in the media and all you see is, oh, they're kinky, they're into whips and chains and wearing black leather, and that's the only perspective they can give on it, and it's the only way they can talk about kink is that person must be traumatized or that person must have something wrong with them, rather than a variety of reasons and a variety of nuances within those reasons themselves. And it's really interesting to hear more of them, and I'm sure there's, you could make a podcast series that's 100 times longer than this and still not come to the end of all the different perspectives that so many different people have. Earlier, I think it was while we were chatting and not while we were recording, but you said that you've got about 30 countries listening to this podcast. And I'm sure if you interviewed someone who was from any one of those countries about what it's like for them with the different culture, with different environments, maybe with different resources available, you'd get a completely different story about their kink experience and whether they're able to do it or what's it like for them. And that could be really interesting to find out. Also, I really liked Cara's last question of what does kink mean to you, because it's just, there is no one answer, and there is no although some people do give some very beautiful answers on what it means to them, that doesn't have to apply to someone else, and it's quite lovely to hear more of them and to hear more about kink, because there is never going to be someone who knows everything and who is able to give all the answers. We're all just kind of figuring out what it means to us and all the different facets we can see of the diamond, which is kink. Oh, that's an awful metaphor. I need to keep talking because that
kind of. No, I like that. I was going to say I like it. The diamond that is kink. That's actually what I'm going to call this episode now, the diamond that is kink. So that is what it is. I'm not kidding. That is what it's going to be. And no one's going to be like, what on earth is it called that, until they get to the end. So we will wrap up there, if that's okay. Much as you found that a cringy metaphor, I thought it was kind of amusing and fun. I kind of quite liked it. I think that's a kind of good point. So I just kind of wanted to say, like, thank you to my two guests here. Thank you to University of Warwick Fetish Society, or FETSUC. Do you have any kind of immediate promos? I'm assuming you want to kind of promote, obviously, the Fetish Society for those who might be local to the Warwick Uni, but you are welcome to, or not, kind of promote any kind of personal kind of things that you've got, any socials, and, you know, we will kind of put that in our show notes as well. So Agala, have you got any?
So I would like to say, if you are a student of the University of Warwick, please feel free to approach us. We've got Facebook, we've got email, and if you reach out to us on one of those, we can add you to the more private social medias that we have. At the minute, we aren't accepting people who aren't part of the university, just because of safety and privacy of our members. But if you are part, we would love to talk to you, and I hope that you think that we're lovely, chatty people in the society from this podcast.
Cool, brilliant, thank you. And I said, as someone who's attended one of the workshops, I would recommend them, they are very good. And Cara, have you got anything you'd like to kind of share, promote, talk about quickly?
I mean, I'm graduating now, so I'm gonna have to get a real job. And I'm afraid it's not a cool, kinky job like being an amazing dominatrix or working in cabaret or anything. I wish. I'm getting a very boring job. So I don't really have anything to promote. other than to mimic Gala. We're awesome. I love the society. And if you don't have a society like this at your university, set one up. I was in the founding year. I was on founding exec. It's actually not that difficult to do it in the UK. If you're at another university, feel free to message us and we'll give you tips on how we set up Pet Talk. So yeah, go forth and be kinky.
Amazing. So yeah, with that, I think we can just say goodbye. So bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
And there we have it. That is our very first season finished. I just wanted to give a massive thank you to all of our guests, all of our wonderful speakers. All of them have very kindly donated their time to this, so none of them have been kind of like been paid for their time. I just wanted to pass on a massive thanks, and please give them the wonderful support just to have such kind of wonderful and kind of fruitful conversations with us and with you, the listener. The series absolutely would not have been what it is without them. I can't talk about the things that they spoke about anywhere near as in depth. So yes, massive thank you as always. Do the survey, follow us on Queer Disrupt on all of our socials. We have Insta, Twitter and Facebook, all at Queer Disrupt. Sometimes with the slash, sometimes without, depending on how picky things are. I'm pretty sure Twitter is without the slash, whereas the rest are with. Yes, drop us an email at hello@queerdisrupt.com if you would like to say hello. And yeah, fill in our survey, let us know, and we'll hope to see you soon at our future events and with our future podcasts. Thanks for listening again, and goodbye.